Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is January 8th, 2017. Today is the baptism of our Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, Scripture admonishes us that all things should be done decently and in order. To that end, the Constitution and bylaws of this congregation establish various officers and responsibilities to which men and women are elected or appointed to serve. In so doing, the Church follows the example of the early Christian Church as described in Acts chapter 6. The 12 summoned the full number of the disciples and said, "It is not right that we should give up preaching the word of God to serve tables. Therefore, brothers, pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, whom we will appoint to this duty. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." The Apostle Peter writes in his first epistle, "As each has received a gift, use it to serve one another, as good stewards of God's varied grace. Whoever speaks, as one who speaks oracles of God. Whoever serves, as one who serves by the strength that God supplies, in order that in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. To him belong glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen." You have been elected to serve as members of the Church Council of St. John Evangelical Lutheran Church. You are to work with a pastor that our life together in Christ may be orderly and pleasing in his sight. You are to see that the services of God's house are held at the proper times, that the word of God is purely preached and taught according to the Lutheran confession, that the sacraments of Christ are administered according to his institution, that provision is made for the Christian instruction of young and old, that the erring are admonished, and that discipline is maintained. You are to see that the temporal affairs of this congregation are properly administered, and that proper support is provided for the workers of this congregation. You are to assist in caring for the poor and the sick, in cultivating harmony among the members, in promoting the general welfare of the congregation, and in furthering the kingdom of Christ here and throughout the world. While holiness of life and obedience to Christ are expected of all members of the congregation, it is especially important that you, as office bearers and members of the council and his church, show yourselves by word and example to be faithful to him in service and Christian devotion. In the presence of God and in this congregation, I therefore ask you, You accept these responsibilities entrusted to you, and you promise faithfully to carry out your duties, trusting the Lord and confirming yourself to his word in accordance with the faith of the Evangelical Lutheran Church. And so answer, I do, and I ask God to help and guide.
I do, and I ask God to help and guide.
Beloved in the Lord, you have heard the promises of faithfulness spoken by these men and women whom you have selected to serve as members of the Church Council of St. John Evangelical Lutheran Church. You promise to support them in their work, to remember them in your prayers, and to work with them to the best of the abilities that God has given you, so that he may be glorified in his work and be done in our midst. If so, then answer, we do by the help of God. Brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, I install you as members of the Church Council of St. John Evangelical Lutheran Church, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Almighty and most merciful God enlighten and strengthen you in your work, so that you may be good and faithful stewards to the glory of his name and to the good of his people. Amen. Let us pray. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we give thanks that you raised up these servants for work among your people. We humbly implore you to grant them, by your Holy Spirit, those gifts needed for the faithful carrying out of their task, most especially wisdom, strength, and willing hearts. Let your blessing rest on this congregation. Strengthen the faith, quicken the love, and enkindle the zeal of its members, that your name may be glorified, and that here and in all places under heaven, the kingdom of your Son may be advanced. We remember with thanksgiving those who have faithfully served your people and have now completed their time of service. We pray that in the end of days, we, with all your faithful people, may hear the voice of Christ saying, come ye who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Go in the name of the Lord. Be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that in the Lord your labor is not in vain. The Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you. Amen. I now ask that the congregation turn to page 94 in the front of your worship book, as we prepare our hearts and minds for worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom our hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
God, who is rich in mercy, loved us even when we were dead in sin and made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Almighty God, strengthen you with power through the Holy Spirit, that Christ may live in your hearts through faith. Amen. We now begin our worship with hymn number 310, Song of Thankfulness and Praise, located in the back of your worship. Hymn number 310.
This Sunday, we're celebrating the baptism of Jesus Christ. Our opening hymn is Songs of Thankfulness and Praise, This hymn was written by Christopher Wordsworth in the 1800s, but the music was written by Johann Sebastian Bach in the 1600s, a very old hymn, thankfulness for our baptism, and also thankfulness for the Epiphany that we've just celebrated.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the home.
Let us pray. O God, our Father, at the baptism of Jesus, you proclaimed him your beloved Son and anointed him with the Holy Spirit. May all who are baptized into Christ, faithful to their calling, to be your daughters and sons, and empower us all with your Spirit, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated as we listen to the reading of God.
Diane Myers will be doing the readings.
First reading is from Isaiah chapter 42. Here is my servant who I uphold, my chosen, in whom my soul delights. I put my spirit upon him. He will bring forth justice to the nations. He will not cry or lift up his voice or make it heard in the street. A bruised reed he will not break, and a dimly burning wick he will not quench. He will faithfully bring forth justice. He will not grow faint or be crushed until he has established justice in the earth, and the coastlands wait for his teaching. Thus says God the Lord, who created the heavens and stretched them out, who spread out the earth and what comes from it, who gives breath to the people upon it, and spirit to those who walk in it. I am the Lord. I have called you in righteousness. I have taken you by the hand and kept you. I've given you as a covenant to the people, a light to the nations, to open the eyes that are blind, to bring out the prisoners from the dungeon, from the prison, those who sit in darkness. I am the Lord, that is my name. My glory I give to no other, nor my praise to idols. See, the former things have come to pass. And new things I now declare. Before they spring forth, I tell you of them. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Becky Dimitroff will be doing the song.
I truly understand that God shows no partiality, but in every nation, anyone who fears him You know the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ. He is Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced, how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power, how he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. We are witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and in Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all the people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and drank with him after he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach to the people and to testify that he is the one ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sins through his name. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our pastor, Pastor John Pollock, will be reading the gospel. This is the gospel acclamation. Pastor Pollock will now be reading the gospel. Diane Myers has read the lesson.
The gospel according to St. Matthew, the third chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus came from Galilee to John at the Jordan to be baptized by him. John would have prevented him, saying, I need to be baptized by you, and you come to me. But Jesus answered him, let it be so now, for it is proper for us in this way to fulfill all righteousness. Then he consented. And when Jesus had been baptized, just as he came up from the water, suddenly the heavens were opened to him, and he saw the Spirit of God descending like a dove and alighting on him. A voice from heaven said, this is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased. The Gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
You may be seated. A couple of announcements. Share with me quickly. You may have already heard, but if you haven't, we unfortunately discovered this week that some of our mail has been tampered with over the past several months, evidently by people gathering for the rainbow table. It was discovered when we moved the pew out there where they sit and found a number of torn up checks. Found some cards that had been sent to the church. There was one card from a couple to me for my wishing me a fast recovery from my surgery, which was in July. Also checks from back in April and sooner. So if you have sent a check to the church and it has not cleared your bank, and you wonder why, it's a good possibility it was ripped up by this individual or individuals who were doing this, or if you had sent a card or some other kind of correspondence to the church and never heard a response, it's a good possibility that is a reason. So please check your checkbooks and your bank statements, because again, as I say, we are trying to call the people whose checks we do have that we found torn up, but we're sure by looking at the dates, since this started back in April earlier, that probably some people were wondering why their check has not come through. Also, there's a new flyer sign-up sheet downstairs on the bulletin board in the hallway. So if you would like to donate flyers for one of our Sunday worships, the entire year is up, so you can sign up for whatever month or months you wish to donate flyers. Also, our noise jar, which now is empty in front of the pulpit. Through that this year, we collected $200, so all your change amounted to $200, so congratulations on that. And confirmation class for those 6th, 7th grade or older, if you have not had confirmation, will begin Saturday, January 21st at 10:30 here at the church. Now would you please give your attention to the clock.
Okay.
for today. Accepted, not necessarily approved. Matthew chapter 3, emphasis on verse 7. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Does being accepted mean being approved? In our gospel lesson for today, we read of the baptism of our Lord Jesus Christ. This marks that break from celebrating his birth and infancy, which we have been doing since Christmas Eve through the 12 days of Christmas, culminating with Epiphany, the Feast of the Epiphany on Friday. Now we focus on Jesus' earthly earth, adult life, and between now and the Transfiguration and the Ash Wednesday, the beginning of Lent, we focus on this first year of his ministry for the most part. So we see that Jesus goes to John to be baptized, and John, of course, first refuses, recognizing who Jesus is, but then Jesus convinces him to do it. And we read that then as Jesus came up out of the water, the heavens opened and a voice was heard which said, which is our 17th verse, "This is my Son, the Beloved, with whom I am well pleased." Now the phrase "well pleased" means to take pleasure in, to take delight in, or to approve. So that brings up the question of, does God approve of you? Now, God accepts you as his child through the waters of baptism, accepts you as his child through your faith in Jesus Christ, but does he approve of you? It's like growing up when our parents accept us as their son or daughter, but they might not approve of everything we do. For an example, when I was growing up, up through the beginning of seventh grade, most of the fellows that I went to school with and my cousins wore our hair like I've got it now. I guess I'm going back to reliving my childhood. You know, wore burr haircuts, or if we wanted to be a little fancier, we wore a flat top or a crew cut. This was basically the style. Then along came four fellows from Liverpool called the Beatles, and suddenly all those guys wanted to have Beatle haircuts. Well, my parents accepted me, but they did not approve of me trying to let my hair grow long. And being involved in athletics, the coaches absolutely did not approve of us trying to let our hair grow long, and established this rule about your hair had to be three fingers above your eyebrow, which basically destroyed the idea of a beetle haircut, because there had no bangs when you're three fingers above your eyebrows. Well, then there came the fact with the Beatles, and then the whole British invasion, the Rolling Stones, and Animals, and Dave Clark Five, Hermits, Freddie the Dreamers, and Zombies, all those different groups from England. With that also came this upsurge in buying records. And unlike my parents, who when they played one of their favorite records, would put a record on the stereo, Perry Como or Dean Martin or Frank Sinatra or the fellow that used to be on the Jackie Gleason show all the time that would come in. If you remember the Jackie Gleason show, Jackie Gleason would be behind the bar being a bartender, and this guy came in like he was drunk, and then Jackie Gleason would say, "Put a coin in number so-and-so." And, you know, the jukebox supposedly would come on, this guy suddenly would sing, and he had a fantastic voice. You know, that's the kind of album they put on, Tony Bennett. And they'd always play it low and soft. Well, here I come along with the records I'm buying. I put them on the stereo, and I crank the thing up as loud as I can crank it without it hurting my ears. And they didn't accept my music, nor did they approve of my playing so loud. I remember one night in the car, we were all, family was together, we were going somewhere. It seemed like it was something in the church, maybe it was a Lenten, midweek Lenten service. And Dad was twisting the knob through the radio channels, and he came to one of the popular rock and roll stations in Louisville, and I said, "Dad, stop it there," because it was a song that really liked Dad. I'm not listening to that. That's not music. And I made a vow to myself. I still remember this. I said, when I have children, I'm not going to be like that with their music. I'm going to let them play with them. Well, along comes Aaron, being the oldest, and he starts into getting into music, and he's cranking out Megadeth and all these other heavy metal groups. And then one of his buddies on his birthday gives him a rap album and a CD. I said, that's it. That's out of here. None of this music. And I played it in the car. So I accepted my son, but I sure didn't approve of the music he was listening to, contrary to what I said. So this is the question. We know God accepts us because we've been baptized into Jesus Christ. We've been adopted by God as his child, an heir to the kingdom. But does he approve of us? When we consider the baptism of Jesus, God accepts and approves of Jesus at his baptism. As we hear, his heavens open, and as God said, this is my son, the beloved, with whom I am well pleased. The phrase, my beloved son, that word beloved, means to cherish, to esteem, to think well of, and acceptance. So God is saying he accepts his son because he is fulfilling his command. Then the word well pleased, as I mentioned before, means to take pleasure in and to approve. So God accepts and approves of Jesus Christ. Of course, why wouldn't he? He was his only son. Jesus was doing what he was supposed to do. God approves of Jesus because of his actions. He is fulfilling his Father's command, and he's being obedient to his word. Now, this is in direct conflict with our first parents in the garden, who for a while followed God's command and were obedient to his word. But then when they were tempted that day by Satan, they just couldn't resist the temptation, and they gave in and disobeyed God's word and ate the fruit from the forbidden fruit from the tree of knowledge. And so they were banished, and sin entered into the world. Well, Jesus, being God's son, doesn't do that. When Satan tries to tempt him, he resists the temptation. And he continues to fulfill his Father's will all the way to going to the cross at Golgotha, paying the debt of sin that we owe through that horrible death, rising on the third day, 40 days later, ascending into heaven, giving to us that victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil. So Jesus was accepted and approved. Now, let us take a look at society for a moment while we still consider this question of are we approved? In society, to be approved in society, you must be accepted. And sometimes acceptance is not easy in the world in which we live. For example, if you are different from those that you interact with, oftentimes you're ignored, or people will refuse to accept you because you are different. Whether it's a difference in race, creed, color, whether it's a difference in socioeconomic standing, whether it is a difference in vocation or profession, whether it's a difference in educational level, whether it's a difference in your likes and dislikes, there are certain areas of society where if we are different, we will be an outcast. And we will be approved. Another example is if you don't follow the status quo. It's changing somewhat now in America compared to what it was when I was growing up. But traditionally, there were just certain norms and values in American society that if you wanted to be successful, you had to follow. And if you didn't follow them, you're an outcast. If you tried to be different, you were looked down upon. Those of us gathered here for the most part, except for a few, will remember the counterculture of the 60s, the people referred to as the hippies. No, they had the right to do what they did. Constitution guarantees us free expression. But most people were turned off by the hippies with their long hair and their bell bottoms and and their anti-establishment attitude. Of course, it was amazing that some of these hippies who seemed to embrace that lifestyle so much while they were in college totally changed when it came to finding a job. And some of them even ended up on Wall Street making millions of dollars after going all through this period of being anti-this, anti-that. But that is the type of thing that not following the status quo can cause you to be unacceptable and therefore not approved. It's just like today. And this isn't to criticize anyone. Again, you have the freedom to do what you want to express yourself. But the hard reality is, if you go in and interview for a job, and your face is covered with piercings and tattoos, and you have tattoos all over your arms and piercings, you're probably not going to get a second interview. It's just because most businesses want a different image than that. And again, a person has a right to do that. It's their free expression. We should not condemn it. But the hard reality is, not fitting the status quo often means a lack of approval. Or if you offer new ideas or try to promote change in certain areas, you're not going to be approved. You're not going to be accepted. People are going to reject you. So in the secular world, you have to be approved in order to be accepted. Depending on what you're involved in, depends on the degree of what you have to be approved of in order to be accepted. You remember in high school, there were certain groups and so forth when you had to meet certain criteria to be part of that group, or you weren't considered in. Tell a story of myself, when my dad, after opening up a new high school and being principal of a brand new high school in Jefferson County, Kentucky for 6 years, decided that, and that was back in the days when teachers and principals still like today, were paid very much. Dad decided if he was going to put 3 kids through college, he needed to become a college professor, so he needed to earn his doctorate. So we said goodbye to Louisville and moved to Lexington, because at that time the University of Kentucky was the only university that offered doctoral degrees. The University of Louisville, where Dad had done his undergrad, only offered doctoral degrees in dentistry and medicine at the time, and in law, at law school. So we go to Lexington for 2 years while Dad earns his doctorate degree in education. Well, Lexington, they had kind of a class barrier. And it wasn't just based on race. Lexington was a 507 town. And if you weren't a descendant of one of the 50 families from before the war between the states, or if you weren't of a certain socioeconomic status, you were looked down upon no matter the color of your skin. So we move, and I go to this new junior high school, and of course my dad, being a graduate assistant at UK, wasn't making very much money, and my mother was staying home to take care of his kids, so she wasn't working. And so the first couple of days in school, I was having a rough time, until it was discovered that my dad was at the UK and employed by UK as a graduate assistant, and that changed everything. If you were connected with UK, it didn't matter your socioeconomic status. You belong to the big blue nation, that made you okay. So suddenly my status rose because Dad was part of the big blue nation, being a graduate student in UK. So this is the way the secular world works. There are all kinds of requirements to be accepted and be approved. But what about the community of faith? As Christians, as I've already mentioned, we have acceptance without approval. In the church, we are to be accepted in Christ Jesus, whether we approve of you and your life or not. For in the church, socioeconomic status is not to be considered when someone wants to be a follower of Jesus Christ. In the church, your educational status is not a requirement for approval to be a member of the community of faith. In the church, your status in society has no relevance of being accepted as a member of the community. faith. In the church, even your character has no relevance to be accepted as a child of God in the community of faith. What matters is being baptized in the Lord Jesus Christ, being adopted through baptism by the Heavenly Father as a child and an heir to the kingdom, and having that faith in Jesus Christ, in his atoning death upon the cross, his resurrection on that third day, 40 days later ascending, and giving us that victory over sin, death, and the power of the devil. So Jesus accepts us where we are and how we are. He puts no qualifications upon us. He accepts us, warts and all. And we only have to look at Jesus' earthly ministry to see this put into action. The disciples that Jesus called, the 12 disciples. All of us know about Matthew. Matthew was a tax collector. Matthew was a seller to the Romans. He was oppressing his own people on behalf of the Roman. As a tax collector, he was allowed to not only collect the tax that Caesar demanded, but to add a couple of percentage points in order to enrich himself. So he was despised by the Jewish people. He was an outcast. He was a traitor. And yet Jesus accepts him as a disciple, even though he doesn't approve of what he's doing. But then there was an apostle who was even worse than that, that many of you may not realize because you're not familiar with what the term means. And that's the apostle known as Simon the Zealot. A zealot was today a terrorist. A zealot was a member of a group who vowed to overthrow the Roman Empire. They spent all their time trying to assassinate Roman officials, trying to rally the people to a popular uprising against the Roman legion. They hated Rome and everything about it. They carried daggers on them, in which when they were in a crowded area that they could disappear into quickly, they would take their dagger out and stab a Roman in the back and then just disappear in the crowd. Jesus calls this terrorist to be a disciple. He doesn't approve of what he's doing, but he accepts him as a sinner who needs forgiveness and repentance. And he sees in him someone that God can redeem. Then we have the famous woman who had committed adultery. And the crowd chases her to Jesus. And they wait for Jesus to give them the command to stone her to death for committing adultery. And Jesus instead says, "He who is without sin may cast the first stone." Of course, none of them there are sinners. So one by one, they drop their stones and disappear. So Jesus looks at the woman and said, "Who is left to condemn you?" And she says, "No one." And he says, "Neither do I. Go and sin no more." See, Jesus accepted that woman, warts and all. But then he also gave her the word of life, to repent, to change her life. She was accepted, even though he did not approve of her prior behavior. And then the last example, the most famous, is the repentant thief on the cross. Here is a man who probably had participated in Barabbas' attempt to overthrow the Romans. Here was a man who had spent his life robbing his own people on the highways. He's the type of person that was responsible for the traveler who was beat up and left to die on the road to Jericho, that the Good Samaritan comes and rescues and leaves at the end of the hill. This is the type of person he was, a criminal, professional criminal, a thug, and an insurrectionist, or today we call him a terrorist. And yet he reaches out to Jesus. "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus accepts it because of his faith. He doesn't approve of his past life. He doesn't approve of what he's been. But he accepts him so that he can be redeemed. And that is what we are to do as the church. We are never to uphold false standards of membership that keeps someone seeking that repentance and that love of God through Jesus Christ from our community of faith because we don't approve of their race, creed, color, their profession, their vocation, their lifestyle, whatever it is. Because just like that crowd that gathered to stone. told that woman. We all sin and fall far short of the glory of God. We're accepted, but our sin is not approved. But that sin has been washed in the blood of the Lamb. And so as God has shown us mercy through our Lord Jesus Christ, we are to show others mercy and accept anyone who comes seeking salvation through the Lord Jesus Christ. For think about it. If we had to wait for Jesus' approval of our behavior, we'd still be waiting. And we'd be waiting until the day we die. Because we'll never approve of sin. But he accepts those who come to him seeking forgiveness and salvation. None of us are obedient to God as Jesus was. None of us follow his commands or his words like Jesus did. But Jesus still is to be our example. As we live our daily life, we are to try and follow God's commands and be obedient to his word. Our Heavenly Father, out of his great love for us, accepts us through our baptism into Christ and through our faith into Christ, even when not always approving of what we say or do. So faith in Christ, unlike the demands of society, gives us acceptance, even if not approved. Acceptance as a child of God and an heir to the kingdom. Therefore, we give thanks to our Heavenly Father for his grace given to us in Jesus Christ, accepting us even when not approving of what we do. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Before we go to O Lord, What a Morning, hymn 438, in the back of your worship book, you can go ahead and turn to that one. I give you these sermon notes each week, and I forget that the church where I got the idea from has one of those screens, so as a preacher's preaching, they fill in the blanks of their sermon notes, as he's pretty soon you know you're putting in the right answer. I never think about whether or not you've gotten the right answer or you understood the question. So today I have a couple on here that didn't exactly follow exactly what I said in the sermon. So quickly I want to give you the answers. Question one, God accepts and approves of Jesus at his baptism. Number three, God approved of Jesus and his actions because he was obedient to God's command and to his word. The next one, the one that probably might have been hardest for you to fill in, number 10, our Heavenly Father, out of his great love for us, accepts us through our baptism into Christ and through our faith in Christ, even when not always approving of what we say or do. Faith in Christ, unlike society, gives us acceptance, even if we are not approved, and we are accepted as a child of God and an heir to the kingdom. So those are the answers I was hoping that you would be able to fill in as I was preaching. So let us now sing, Oh Lord, What a Morning, hymn number 438, in the back of your worship.
This is an African-American spiritual sung on the plantations when the African-Americans were enslaved. Nobody knows who wrote it. It's about the end of time. My Lord, what a morning.
we profess our faith with the Apostles' Creed on page 105. With the whole church, let us confess our faith. I believe
in God, Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth.
I believe
in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray that the dawn from on high will shine for the church, the world, and all of those in need. Our response today is, hear us, we pray. For all who are baptized in Christ and anointed with the Holy Spirit, that their mission and ministry may be a light to the nations. God of light and life, hear us, we pray. For all who govern and serve, that justice and peace be established in all corners of the earth. God of light and life,
hear us, we pray.
For those weakened by age or illness, that you take them by the hand and uphold them with your Spirit. God of light and life,
hear us, we pray.
For all who doubt that they are your sons and daughters, that they may be assured by the voice of your promise. God of light and life,
hear us, we pray.
For our congregation, that we will not grow weary or faint as we share your grace and forgiveness with all people. God of light and life,
hear us, we pray.
In thanksgiving for all the saints, that your light upon their lives may guide us also to be instruments of healing and peace. God of light and life,
hear us, we pray.
God of splendor and light, hear our prayer and illumine us with the radiance of your glory shown in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
It's now time for our offering. This is St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Our ushers are Sharon Leach and Helen Wallace. They're coming forward now to receive the offering from the people here. This is January the 8th, 2016. This is the day after we celebrated Epiphany, and today we're celebrating the baptism of Jesus Christ. We have worship service here at 8 o'clock every Sunday, and also we have Sunday school at 9:15. We have worship service you're watching now. It's a 10:30 service. St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio, celebrating the baptism of our Lord. We have had the installation of the church council today. The president of the church council is Linda Fox. You saw that at the beginning of this video. The installation of the church council will be serving as council governing our church for this year. Pastor Pollock installed the church council today. And then we have the service of the word, because on the first and the third Sundays we have Holy Communion, but this is the second Sunday, so we're now celebrating the service of the Word. We, at Lutheran Church, we honor the sacrament of Holy Communion. We serve Holy Communion every Wednesday night at our Wednesday night service, but we also honor the Bible, and this is the service of the Word, honoring the Bible today, and also the baptism of Jesus Christ. As Jesus accepts us, he may not approve of us, but he always accepts us and never turns us away. And we at the church, we're all sinners, we're called by God. Now here's the offering, and Helen Wallace and Sharon Leach have brought forth the offering plates. Now we'll have the rest of the service. Pastor Pollock will lead us in the following service of the Word today. Come join us anytime. You can worship with us, service of the Word, or Holy Communion.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and conclude our worship with hymn number 305, When Jesus Came to Jordan. Hymn number 305, When Jesus Came to Jordan.
This hymn was written by Fred Pratt Green, 1903, and the music is an English folk tune. And we're meditating now on Jesus' baptism. When Jesus came to Jordan and was accepted by God, God was pleased with him. He said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." Jesus came to Jordan in his baptism. This hymn is written by Fred Pratt Green, music English folk tune. Springfield, Ohio, the corner of Wittenberg, Columbia. We invite you to come worship with us anytime. We have many ministries for the poor. Rainbow Table on Friday. Call the church and volunteer as we are trying to help the poor through our outreach in the community. We're happy to bring you this service. Our church is at Springfield, Ohio, corner of Wittenberg, Columbia. We thank you for joining us in our worship. We hope this continues to bless you and keep you in all your days. We will pray for you. Continue to pray for us and support our YouTube ministry. The flowers today are presented by Gina Pollock to the glory of God. And it's in memory of her sister, Charlene Miller, who was called to the church militant and called from the church militant to the church triumphant in December of 2016. These flowers were given by Gina Pollock in memory of her sister who died December 2016. Also Nelson Klopfenstein in memory of January 7th birthday of Ruth Klopfenstein. This is January the 8th, 2017. January the 8th, 2017. Just when it's finished 2016. Now we're getting 2017. New church year. We celebrate the Epiphany. Now today we celebrate Jesus' baptism. We thank you for worshiping with us.